noted as well, something that's not in the policy, as it's only recently emerging with any certainty, but there will be provisions within the bus services bill around audiovisual announcements on buses. We're waiting to see the kind of hard detail on that, on what it will look like, but clearly that's going to the future form part of the provision of real-time information to customers. So a further incentive to make sure all the systems are working correctly behind the scenes and the information is being the information is accurate and reliable. So again, I have to take any questions.
Thanks, Matt. Gordon and Natalie.
It's the fact that we're going to be phasing out the extreme it's not in the staff station. There's one of the things I think I'd like to see, rather than people asking me a question and me saying I've forgotten the answer to the problem at some point in the future, is if we can do some kind of media release to say this is the way we're going to be phased out, so people do understand before we just suddenly see it happening. Is that something where if you've got number 7 on page 29 communication issues, so will that be as a communication issue?
Just for clarity, really, we're not proposing to phase out screens. I think that at some point they'll come to the end of their natural life, and then what we're proposing here is that we don't replace them, but we'll still maintain screens that are there. I think people in those locations have kind of got used to them. So this isn't about next week we're going to send them under the van round to take them all out. This is about kind of giving us a bit of a way forward that's financially sustainable.
Thank you, Chair. Thanks very much for that report. Obviously, that's touched on the question that I asked Howard previously, and he said, gave me his word that he was committed towards working with Merseytravel to ensure this happened. I'm quite happy you mentioned the audio information, because if I'm in a bus in London, you can know where you stop it. So for people who are visually impaired, that is quite helpful. So I think that's a real positive, and I look forward to seeing what's coming up. Thank you.
Mary? Yeah, Matt, can I just say thank you for the reports, but more importantly, thank you for item 6 on it, which is the equality and diversity implications. I know this is dear to Pam's heart, my colleague, but you know when you read that, and I have been to that many meetings in that many places, including the city of Liverpool, that is spot on. And that saves people asking 20 supplement questions because you've already answered them. And I would love to see every paper to that standard. It's brilliant, and thank you.
Terry?
Thanks, Martin. In relation to getting companies to sponsor RTI boards for the advertising revenue, whatever method they use, whether they use a flat screen, whether they use a ticket board screen, it's a great idea to do that because obviously cost burden is on the advertising company. You mentioned that the people who currently operate the bus stops, Clear Channel, that they would, are you talking with anyone else aside from that? And the local companies have got an interest in doing this because, as Howard said before, RTI is important when the buses are at 20, 30 minute intervals rather than 2 or 3 minute intervals, because it becomes irrelevant then because only 2 minutes to wait. RTI is really bonus. But 20 or 30 minute intervals, an hour intervals, are more than likely the roll of buses, the roll of bus stops where people are actually stopping in the middle of nowhere and they work with bus.
I think it's simple to our contract with TCUK, and it's by exclusivity to it, so it's not necessarily easy to kind of go and talk elsewhere. But if I may, just a few points around the advertising screens. One of the things which I don't think is that well understood is actually if you provide useful information on, for example, those digital screens, then it makes people look at them. So actually that drives an increased advertising revenue for Clear Channel. So you might wonder kind of why would they be interested in kind of
80s Merseytravel and Walrus car activation fee. And Liz is ready.
Thanks, Chair. What we're asking
the
members to do is first introduced to the audience, and obviously we are going to have a committee of the commission.
councillors. I think it's quite right that there should be a charge. Obviously, it's cost of the authority, obviously, the taxpayers throughout the region, or that's in the interest of the card holder to have it activated and registered. I didn't hear you mention that it will be registered to any particular individual. But I'll give you an example. What happened the other day? One of my colleagues found a purse in the back of his car. There was a Walrus card in it, £50 in cash, a couple of photographs of the kids, and a key. The only thing with any possible identification was the Walrus card. But the only identification that you get from that was the shop which you bought from. So, other than giving it to the police for somebody to come and find it, there's no way of anyone, absolutely no one, even though that card should be. It should have, at the very least, the house number, the postcode, and a person's name on. You know, and we should actually have that data. Because data moving forward, our public transport can be used. Data is extremely valuable. I'm pretty sure these guys would like to know the email address of every customer that's got on their bus. There's a potential way of doing that.
To make sure it comes to the car, that's certainly what's planned. So obviously, on each Walrus card, it's got a unique identifier. We made the decision that we were going initially with an anonymous scheme, and that was because of where we were when we kind of reinvigorated our smart program to achieve that aim and make Walrus be smart platform and the technology transfer very quickly. We recall at Breach, we thought that we talked about
charges applied to this because my family come up to Liverpool, they all have Walrus card, and they're ecstatic because in London they have to pay for their Oyster card, so they think Liverpool everything is free. So I think it's only fair, and you know, thanks goes out to the staff, because in terms of since the launch of the Walrus in 2015, over 500,000, that's remarkable. That shows that people have latched on to the whole concept, and you know, it's exciting time, and it's all paper free, as you said. So thank you to the team, really, really good.
Thanks, Chair. To reiterate, I think what Natalie's just said, I'd like to thank Liz personally and the team for all the hard work on this, and particularly for all the additional products that we're actually getting on this. I think, in a sense, it's a no-brainer, really, given the current financial situation we find ourselves in. I think it's inevitable that we have to have this price. So I think in terms of retention, people are much more likely to take it seriously and look after it more as they've actually paid, even though it's only been £900. But again, I'd like to reiterate my thanks to Liz and the team for all the hard work on this. Thank you very much.
Get a real walrus for a clergyman doing well. Can I move the recommendations in paragraph 2 of the report, if that's agreed? Marvellous. And the last item is the 2017-18 Merseytravel Corporate Plan and Performance Reporting Process. Carol is going to present this one.
We've all got a copy of the board, we've all seen a copy of the
subject, going back to earlier comments about carbon reductions, I just wondering under our mission, is it possible to include sustainable in some way? And I'm always banging on about this, I'm trying to save the planet, I'm sure everybody else is.
Sustain it in the mission as much as it is in the vision. Go on.
Thank you, Chair. I think it's a pretty good comprehensive document. The one that we've got on page 4 where we talk about productivity, we talk about the movement of goods. We then go further on the next page to mention about the Liverpool trip, the investment that's going on there. I think in some ways, I mentioned the fact that we like these books to be going by rail freight as well, just because of the topical matters that are there occurring around that area at the moment. My understanding is under that heading of productivity, that is where what we'd allude to. So there's not specifically mentioning that. Have you got Frankfurt? I know I've missed a bit out on my friend. You'll tell me what page you're in.
Not saying great, but just go a bit south. We are working with national open partners to maximise the competitive advantage that this presents and have developed a forward looking city region freight strategy.
I knew we'd been there, but I just couldn't be here for tables.
And it's a multimodal one, so it picks up.
Completely disregard that last question, it's not the answer.
Just from my perspective as well, absolutely great. I would just suggest, however, we probably need to. Within kind of document somewhere, perhaps page 55 where we've got the bullet points of what we're responsible for, have something that references the role that we play both in rail north and transport for the north. We do have a kind of very key strategic role in those. But also as well, in light of all the reports and presentations we've had today, we probably should have something that highlights what we're doing in terms of coordinating hosting the bus alliance, because I think not to mention those key three perhaps sell themselves a bit short, so can we kind of include those as well?
Yeah,
to the report, which is to endorse the corporate plan. If that's agreed, there's no urgent AOB, so thank you for your attendance. We'll see you at the next meeting.